All right, get ready because we're taking a deep dive into the wild world of SVTs today. Supraventricular tachycardias, you know. The ones that make your heart feel like it's going to beat right out of your chest. You know, you guys sent me some medical slides on this. And to be honest, they are intense. But luckily, I have an expert here with me today to help us break it all down. And by the end of this, you'll be able to tell your AVNRT from your AVRT. You'll know why those accessory pathways can be so sneaky. And we'll even tackle the mystery of concealed entrainment. You ready to get started?
Absolutely. Let's dive in.
Okay, so first up, AVNRT, atrioventricular nodal reentrant tachycardia. One of the slides shows this ECG, and it's got this pseudo R wave in lead V1. What is a pseudo R wave? It sounds kind of like, I don't know, science fiction or something.
It's not quite sci-fi, but it is pretty fascinating. So the AV node, it acts like a gatekeeper, right? It controls the electrical signals that make your heart beat. But in AVNRT, there's like the double pathway situation. Within the AV node, it's almost like having two gatekeepers trying to do the same job at the same time.
Two gatekeepers? That just sounds like a recipe for chaos.
Exactly. And that's exactly how you get that reentrant circuit. The signal gets kind of caught in the loop between these two pathways. And then that causes the heart to race. And that pseudo R wave you were talking about, that's actually just the electrical echo of the signal. That's caught in that loop.
So it's not a real R wave. It's just like a signal bouncing around. Clever.
Exactly. And another telltale sign that we look for in AVNRT is a short VA interval. That's the time between the activation of the ventricles and the atria. If that interval is less than 60 milliseconds, that's a pretty strong indicator that we're dealing with AVNRT.
So we're looking for that short interval and that pseudo R wave.
Right.
Got it. Now let's talk about AVRT. Atrioventricular reciprocating tachycardia. One of the slides here talks about an AV nodal jump with an echo. Is this where those secret passageways come in?
You got it. AVRT is all about accessory pathways, those extra electrical connections in the heart. They're like little hidden shortcuts that bypass the normal route for the electrical signals.
So instead of going through the usual channels, the signal takes a shortcut.
Exactly. And that shortcut can cause a really fast heartbeat because the signal keeps looping around. Using that shortcut over and over. It's like a fast track for electrical impulses, but not in a good way.
And I remember seeing something in here about these pathways being concealed. What does that even mean?
Yeah, that's where things get a little extra tricky. A concealed accessory pathway is like a one-way street in your heart. The electrical signal can travel down it just fine, but it can't come back the same way. So it's basically hidden from view. Unless we use some specific techniques to try to find.
So it's like a secret entrance, but no exit. I can see how that would cause some confusion.
Yeah, and all that confusion can lead to different types of AVRT, depending on which direction that signal is traveling down that one-way pathway. And that's where we get into orthodromic versus antidromic AVRT.
Okay, I'm seeing a slide here titled Navigating the Maze, Orthodromic versus Antidromic AVRT. Let's try to break this down a little bit.
Okay, so think of it like this. Orthodromic AVRT, it's kind of like taking the scenic route. The signal goes down the usual pathway through the AV node.
Yeah.
And then it comes back up through the accessory pathway.
Okay, so the normal route plus a little detour.
Right. But with antidromic AVRT, the signal takes the express lane. So it goes down the accessory pathway first and then back up through the AV node. So it's basically like cutting in line. And it definitely throws off the heart's normal rhythm.
Okay, so the direction the electrical signal travels determines the type of AVRT. But how do we even know that these pathways are there in the first place?
One of the biggest clues is something called a delta wave. It's this little blip on the ECG. And it shows up when a manifest accessory pathway is present. And there's this clever system called the delta wave algorithm. And it helps us decode where those pathways might be hiding, based on which ECG leads are showing that delta wave.
Wait, so you can actually tell where the pathway is just by looking at the delta wave on different leads?
Yeah.
That's impressive. What if the delta wave is positive in lead V1, for example?
That's a good question. A positive delta wave in V1 usually suggests a left-sided pathway, whereas a negative delta wave in that same lead would suggest a right-sided pathway. It's like having a map to guide us through the heart's electrical system.
Wow, that's really cool. It's like deciphering a secret code. Now, I also see something here about parahysian pacing. Is that another one of our detective tools?
It is. Parahysian pacing is a technique that we use to figure out if the electrical signals are taking the normal route through the AV node or if they're sneaking through an accessory pathway.
So how does that work? Do you actually pace the heart to see what happens?
Exactly. We pace the heart near the His bundle, which is a key part of the electrical conduction system, and then we watch how the signals respond to that pacing. and that helps us determine if an accessory pathway is involved.
So you're basically creating a controlled electrical impulse.
Yeah.
And seeing how it affects the heart's rhythm.
Exactly. And we analyze things like the SH interval, which is the time it takes for the signal to travel from the sinus node to the hisabundle way. They can give us a clearer picture of what's going on.
So it's a powerful tool for kind of unraveling the mysteries of these hidden pathways.
It is.
Okay, so we've talked about AVNRT and AVRT, those reentrant tachycardias. But what happens if somebody also has a bundle branch block?
That's a good question. Bundle branch blocks can definitely make things more complicated.
How so?
Well, imagine that our heart's electrical system is like a highway, and the bundle branches are the lanes. So a bundle branch block is basically like a lane closure. It forces the electrical signal to take a detour.
So the signal has to find a new path.
Right. And that can alter how the signal travels in AVRT, which can change the heart rate.
Okay.
And can also make the rhythm harder to interpret. So it's just an added layer of complexity that we have to take into account.
Okay, so we've got our reentrant tachycardias down. What other types of SVTs are out there?
Well, let's talk about atrial flutter.
Atrial flutter. This is the one with that classic sawtooth pattern on the ECG, right?
Exactly. In atrial flutter, the upper chambers of the heart, the atria, they're not beating effectively. Instead, they're just fluttering really fast. And that's what creates that sawtooth pattern that we see.
And I'm seeing something called concealed entrainment mentioned here. What is that?
Concealed entrainment is a really clever technique that we use to prove that there's a reentrant circuit causing the flutter. So we basically pace the heart from a specific location, and then we see how the flutter responds to that pacing. If we can change the flutter rate by pacing, that confirms that a reentrant circuit is at play.
So you're manipulating the heart's rhythm to figure out what's causing it.
Yeah, think of it like sending in a probe to map out a hidden tunnel. By observing how the pacing affects the flutter, we can actually pinpoint the location of that reentrant circuit.
That's really neat. Okay, now what about atrial tachycardia?
Atrial tachycardia is a different beast altogether. Instead of a reentrant circuit, this one is caused by a single rogue cell in the atrium that decides to take charge and fire off signals at a rapid pace.
So it's not a loop, it's just one cell gone haywire.
Exactly. And finding that rogue cell is crucial for treating atrial tachycardia. We use mapping techniques to pinpoint the source of those rapid signals. Okay. And then we can target it with ablation therapy.
So mapping is really important for understanding and treating these SVTs.
Absolutely. And speaking of chaotic rhythms, we can't forget about atrial fibrillation.
Atrial fibrillation. Ah, yes, that's the one where the heart rhythm is all over the place.
Exactly. Instead of a regular, nice, coordinated heartbeat, the atria are just quivering chaotically. And this can be triggered by various things, including signals coming from the pulmonary veins. Those are the blood vessels that carry oxygen-rich blood from the lungs back to the heart.
So the pulmonary veins can actually trigger atrial fibrillation.
Yeah, they can. And mapping those veins
helps
us identify where those rogue signals are coming from so we can better target them for treatment.
All right. So we've covered a lot of ground with SVTs, but I know these slides also cover ventricular tachycardia. What can you tell us about VT?
Ventricular tachycardia, or VT, is a rapid heart rhythm that originates in the ventricles, the lower chambers of the heart. And there's a whole spectrum of VT, ranging from relatively benign to life-threatening.
So some VTs are not as serious as others.
Right. We can break VT down into two main categories. Idiopathic VT, meaning we don't know the cause. Like, they often originate in the RVOT, the right ventricular outflow tract, and those tend to be less worrisome.
And what about ischemic VTs? Those sound a little more serious.
They can be. Ischemic VTs are associated with scar tissue from previous heart attacks, and that scar tissue disrupts the normal electrical pathways in the ventricles. And that can create the perfect environment for VT to develop.
So one is like a little glitch in a healthy system, and the other is a consequence of damage to the system.
Yeah, that's a good way to put it. And just like with SVTs, mapping plays a critical role in diagnosing and guiding the treatment for VT.
So how do we map ventricular tachycardia?
Well, we use a variety of techniques. Each one gives us unique insights. Pace mapping helps us pinpoint the origin of the VT by basically matching the paced heartbeats to the VT rhythm. Entrainment mapping, similar to what we talked about for atrial flutter, it helps us understand the electrical circuit involved in the VT. And then we have activation mapping that tracks the spread of electrical activity during the VT. And then there's voltage mapping that identifies areas of scar tissue that can harbor those abnormal circuits.
Wow. So there's a whole arsenal of mapping techniques to help us understand VT.
Absolutely. And one particular type of VT that's pretty fascinating is bundle branch reentry VT.
Bundle branch arrhythmia. I think I saw that in the slides.
Yeah. In this type of VT, both bundle branches, the left and the right, are involved in that reentrant circuit. So instead of working together to conduct the electrical signals efficiently, they end up creating a loop that causes that rapid heartbeat.
It's like the wiring in the heart gets crossed.
Exactly. And we can often spot this type of VT on the ECG. It usually have a left bundle branch block pattern and a prolonged HV interval, which is the time it takes for the signal to travel from the His bundle to the ventricles.
Like a telltale sign that the bundle branches are up to no good.
Right. Luckily, bundle branch reentry VT can often be treated with ablation by targeting the right bundle branch to disrupt that loop and restore a normal heart rhythm.
So ablation seems to be a common thread here. It's used to treat a lot of these tachycardias, huh?
It is. Ablation is a minimally invasive procedure that uses radiofrequency energy to create tiny scars in the heart, and that disrupts those abnormal electrical pathways that are causing all the trouble. It's a powerful tool, and it can provide long-term relief for a lot of patients.
It sounds like we've covered just about every type of SVT and VT out there. We've gone from reentry circuits to rogue cells to bundle branch shenanigans. It's a lot to take in. Cardiology is a complex field.
It is. The heart is a remarkable organ, and its electrical system is incredibly intricate. But with careful study and practice, even the most complex concepts can become clear.
Well, I've definitely learned a lot today.
Me too. It's great to revisit these concepts and discuss them in a new light.
So let's recap a little bit of what we've learned today about supraventricular and ventricular tachycardias.
Absolutely. We've explored how abnormal electrical pathways in the heart, whether they're reentrant circuits, rogue cells, or problems with the bundle branches, can lead to these rapid heart rhythms.
We've also learned about the different tools that we have for diagnosing these conditions, like ECG analysis, that delta wave algorithm for AVRT, and all those mapping techniques that help us pinpoint the location of those abnormal pathways.
And we've discussed how ablation, which is a minimally invasive procedure, can be used to effectively treat a lot of these tachycardias by disrupting those troublesome pathways.
We've covered a ton of ground today. And I think we've given you a really good understanding of these complex heart rhythms. But I have to ask, what happens when we do decide to ablate? What are the risks and benefits of such a procedure? That's something to think about as we move on to the next part of our deep dive.
Yeah, that's a great question. It's something that we should definitely consider. Ablation is a really powerful tool. But like any medical procedure, it does come with its own potential benefits and risks as well.
Right. It's definitely important to weigh those carefully. So let's start with the good stuff. What are some of the benefits of ablation?
Well, one of the biggest benefits is the potential for long-term relief from those really bothersome tachycardias. For a lot of folks, ablation can actually be curative, meaning that they might not experience those rapid heart rhythms ever again.
Wow. So it's not just about managing symptoms, it's potentially fixing the problem altogether.
Exactly. And that can make a huge difference in a person's quality of life. They can get back to doing all the things they love without having to worry about their heart racing out of control.
That's amazing. But I know you mentioned risks too. What are some of the things that people should be aware of?
Sure. The risks of ablation are generally pretty low, but it's definitely important to be informed. So some potential complications could include bleeding, infection, damage to the heart's electrical system, and in very, very rare cases, stroke.
Okay, that sounds a little bit scary. Are those complications common?
Not at all. Those are all really rare occurrences. And skilled electrophysiologists take a lot of precautions to try to minimize those risks. Plus, the technology and the techniques for ablation have advanced so much that it's made the procedure even safer and more effective than it used to be.
So it sounds like it's a matter of carefully weighing those potential benefits against the potential risks.
Exactly. Right? The decision to undergo ablation is always a personalized one, and it should always be made in consultation with a healthcare professional. Things like the individual's medical history, the type and severity of the tachycardia, and their overall health. Those are all important factors that come into play.
Right. It's not a one-size-fits-all approach. And is ablation always the first line of treatment for tachycardias?
Not necessarily. For some people, medications might be enough to help control their heart rhythm and keep things under control.
So meds could be a first step before considering something more invasive like ablation.
Often, yes. And for other folks, sometimes even simple lifestyle changes like reducing stress, limiting caffeine, and getting regular exercise can make a big difference in managing their tachycardia. So it's really about finding the best approach for each individual person.
Right. So it's all about personalized medicine, tailoring the treatment plan to the person's specific needs and situation.
I could agree more.
Okay. So we've really dug deep into this world of supraventricular and ventricular tachycardias. We've talked about what causes them, how to diagnose them, and even explored some treatment options like medication, lifestyle changes, and ablation.
Yeah, we've covered a lot of ground. Hopefully you're feeling more confident in your understanding of these really complex heart rhythms.
I know I am. But you know what? We focus so much on these abnormal rhythms. I think it's easy to forget how amazing the heart's electrical system is when it's working properly. How does this intricate network of signals actually make our hearts beat in the first place?
That's a great point. It's easy to get caught up in the problems, but the heart's electrical system really is remarkable. It all starts with this tiny little cluster of cells in the right atrium, called the sinoatrial node, or the SA node for short.
Right, the SA node, that's the heart's natural pacemaker, right?
Exactly. The SA node is like the conductor of the heart's orchestra. It generates those electrical impulses that then spread through the atria, making them contract and pump blood into the ventricles.
Okay, so the signal starts in the SA node, travels through the atria, causing them to contract. Then what happens?
Then the signal reaches another really important structure called the atrioventricular node, or the AV node. And this is where things get interesting. The AV node acts like a gatekeeper. It delays the electrical signal, just slightly.
Why the delay? What's the purpose of that?
Well, that slight pause is crucial. It allows the ventricles time to fill up with blood before they contract. If the signal went straight through, without that delay, the ventricles wouldn't have enough time to fill properly, and the heart wouldn't pump as efficiently.
So the AV node is like a traffic controller, making sure everything flows smoothly and in the right order.
Exactly. And once the signal is passed through the AV node, it travels down something called the His-Purkinje system, which is this network of specialized fibers that rapidly conduct that electrical impulse throughout the ventricles.
And that's what triggers the ventricles to contract.
Precisely. And that coordinated contraction of the ventricles is what pumps the blood out to the body, delivering oxygen and nutrients to every cell. It's this incredible symphony of electrical and mechanical events, all perfectly synchronized.
It really is amazing how this intricate electrical system keeps our hearts beating and keeps us alive.
It is. And it's constantly adapting to our needs, speeding up when we're active, slowing down when we rest. It's truly a marvel of nature.
But as we've seen, sometimes this really delicate system can get disrupted, leading to those tachycardias we've been talking about. And understanding how the system works is really key to understanding how those problems arise and how we can treat them.
I completely agree.
So before we wrap up this part of our deep dive, I have one more question for you. We've talked a lot about mapping the heart's electrical system, but I'm curious, how do those electrical signals actually translate into the physical pumping action of the heart? I mean, how do those tiny little impulses generate the force that's needed to move all that blood?
Ah, that's a fantastic question. It's really the bridge between the electrical world and the mechanical world of the heart. And it all comes down to this intricate interplay between those electrical signals and the muscle cells of the heart, the myocardium.
So the electrical signals are like the triggers and the muscles do the heavy lifting.
Exactly. When that electrical signal reaches a heart muscle cell, it sets off this whole chain reaction that ultimately leads to the muscle contracting. It's like flipping a switch. That activates the cell's pumping power.
Okay, so walk me through this chain reaction. How does an electrical signal actually make a muscle contract?
It's a really fascinating process. It involves ions and proteins and a little bit of fancy footwork at the cellular level. Imagine a heart muscle cell just at rest. It has a negative charge inside compared to the outside.
So there's this electrical potential across the cell membrane.
Precisely. And when that electrical signal, that tiny little impulse, arrives at the cell, it triggers the opening of special channels in the membrane.
Channels, like doorways in the cell wall.
Exactly. And those channels allow ions, like sodium and calcium, to flow into the cell.
And what happens when these ions rush in?
Well, this influx of ions changes the electrical charge inside the cell, making it more positive. And it's that change in charge that triggers the muscle contraction. It's like an electrical switch that turns on the muscle's power.
So the electrical signal acts like a key that unlocks the muscle's ability to contract.
That's a great way to visualize it. And calcium in particular plays a really important role here. It binds to specific proteins within those muscle fibers. And that initiates the cascade of events that leads to the shortening or contraction of the muscle.
And as that heart muscle contracts, it squeezes the blood out of the chambers and into the arteries, propelling it throughout the body.
Exactly. It's this beautifully coordinated sequence of events, a symphony of electrical and mechanical activity that keeps the blood flowing.
It's incredible how this intricate system works tirelessly day in and day out to keep us alive and functioning.
It really is a marvel of nature.
And as we continue to explore the heart, we uncover more and more of these wonders, really inspiring awe and pushing us to learn even more. Speaking of learning more, we've covered so much already. Should we move on to part three of our deep dive?
Yeah, let's do it. It really is remarkable how those electrical signals get translated into the mechanical action of the heart.
I know, it's so cool. We've been talking about these tiny electrical impulses, but how do they actually make the heart muscle work? You know, the myocardium. How does it actually contract and pump the blood?
Right. It's easy to forget that those signals are just the first step. The real workhorse is the muscle itself.
Yeah.
To understand how it all comes together, we need to zoom in, like way in, to the cellular level.
Okay, let's get microscopic. What's happening inside those heart muscle cells?
So picture a single heart muscle cell, just hanging out, totally relaxed.
Mm.
At this point, it has a negative charge inside compared to the outside. And this difference, it's called the membrane potential.
Okay, so it's like a tiny battery just storing up energy.
Exactly. Now, when that electrical signal comes along from the heart's conduction system, it reaches this muscle cell. And it doesn't just pass by. It actually triggers a change in the cell membrane.
What kind of change?
Well, the electrical signal. It causes special channels in the cell membrane to open up, kind of like tiny gates that control what can go in and out of the cell.
Ions, right?
Yep.
Over the charged particles.
Exactly. And some of the key players here are sodium and calcium ions. When those channels open up, these ions, they rush into the cell.
So it's like a sudden influx of charged particles.
Right. And all these charged particles rushing in, they change the electrical charge inside the cell.
Mm-hmm.
And that triggers the muscle contraction. It's like flipping a switch.
Wow. So that electrical signal is literally like a key that unlocks the muscle's power. But how does calcium fit into all of this?
Calcium is crucial here. Once it enters the cell, it binds to specific proteins within the muscle fibers. And that sets off this whole cascade of events that leads to the muscle fibers shortening.
So the electrical signal triggers the calcium,
yeah.
And then the calcium triggers the contraction.
Exactly, like a domino effect.
Wow, a tiny domino effect.
And the end result of all of this is that the heart muscle squeezes, pushing blood out of the chambers and into the arteries,
yeah.
Circulating it throughout the body.
Incredible. This whole interplay of electrical and mechanical activity.
It's a beautiful thing.
It really is. And it happens millions of times a day.
Yeah.
Just to keep us going.
Yeah. It really is a testament to just how amazing the human body is. And the more we learn about it, the better we can take care of ourselves.
Well, I think we successfully navigated this wild world,
yeah,
of supraventricular and ventricular tachycardias today. We started with those mysterious pseudo-R waves. And now we're ending with the intricate dance of ions inside those heart muscle cells.
We did cover a lot. Hopefully it was as interesting for you as it was for me.
Oh, definitely.
The heart is just such a remarkable organ.
I know.
There's always more to discover.
Absolutely. And for all of you listening out there, remember, knowledge is power.
It really is.
Especially when it comes to your health. So the more you know about how your body works, the better you can advocate for yourself and make good decisions. Well, that's all the time we have for today. Thanks for joining us on this deep dive. And until next time, keep exploring, keep learning, and keep that heart beating strong.